no, perfect, perfect. So we are live now, and it gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to the interview series of Mentor My Board, that is Boardroom Talks. Boardroom is a place where fortunes of great companies are written, and hence, in pursuit of bringing the best practices of boardrooms and best practices followed by eminent directors, independent directors, professionals like CEOs, CFOs, CS of corporate India and international boardrooms to you, we have come out with the interview series of with the directors and professionals and business leaders who have been guiding and acting as torch bearers for the corporates and the boardrooms. Let me introduce Mentor My Board to you. Mentor My Board is a platform wherein corporate directors come together to learn, to network, to sharpen their boardroom skills and get opportunity of serving companies to act as directors, independent directors, women directors, and also get mentored by expert mentors on the areas of governance, business, finance, marketing, strategy, and many more. We are on a mission to transform Indian corporate directors and boardrooms and create a community of 1 lakh directors in next 5 years. We help directors who continuously are looking to sharpen their boardroom and leadership skills, upgrade their knowledge on better governance through best board practices, which helps the companies they serve on to grow faster and ethically. Let me tell you, we have been recently doing this Boardroom Talk series, and we have been getting such a wonderful and valuable response from you and suggestions and feedback. So please keep doing it. Please share the talk series with as many directors, aspiring directors, professionals as you can, which will help everyone and overall Indian corporate directors to be imbibing those best practices. Kindly do share, like, subscribe our Facebook, LinkedIn pages, Mentor My Board, our YouTube channel, Mentor My Board, and also join our LinkedIn community of Circle of Directors. So today, I, CS Divya Momaya, with my team, Bharti and Priya, are going to have this Boardroom Talk series with Mr. Jambu Dalal, who's the managing director of Gaviva, an Intuit consulting company, who's ex-CEO, MD of Cisco Systems, D-Link, and he is a technocrat and startup entrepreneur and a passionate leader. So let me just briefly read out his profile. Mr. Jambu Dalal holds a bachelor's in of science degree in mathematics and master's in management from Bombay University. He brings with him 30 years of the industry experience, amongst others. He has held the position of President India SAG at Cisco Systems. He also has served as President at Avia India Private Limited. And at both these organizations, he was involved from their early entry into India to grow their business rapidly to leadership positions and in their respective industries. He was managing director of D-Link India Limited, a diversified listed company in the areas of manufacturing, distribution of networking products and PC components and subsystems. At D-Link, he was involved into the completely reorienting and overhauling the direction and profile of the company. So Mr. Jambu has a wide ranging experience throughout India, SAARC, Asia Pacific, and through his career, which was based in Mumbai, Bangalore, Singapore, and at different times. So currently he's been the managing director of Gaviva, which is a global first digital initiative in the areas of corporate governance and board effectiveness. So he enjoys the competitive bridge and sailing and is passionate about corporate social responsibility and corporate governance initiatives. We are really, really very happy to have you here with us on this platform, sir. And entire team of Mentor My Board welcomes you to this interactive session of Boardroom Talk. So, yes, sir. We are really happy to have you here with us.
Thank you, Divya. Thank you for this wonderful introduction. Before we proceed, I would say it's my honor and privilege to be here. Before I proceed to talk a bit about Mentor My Board, I would really like to thank all the participants would have taken time out on a busy Friday evening to join our session. So thank you all for joining this. I'll try and make it as interesting as possible. I promise you to try and do that. But before I do that, I would be amiss if I don't recognize the fantastic work being done by Mentor My Board, driven by Divya. I think, number one, it's extremely timely. Number two, it fulfills a great need in the market. And especially with Divya's focus on startups, MSMEs, and aspiring directors, which is actually going to be the future of our country. I think it's a great initiative. I've had an opportunity to interact with folks at Mentor My Board, and I'm extremely happy with the work you're doing and very happy to be with you this evening. So thanks for having
Wonderful.
Me.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, sir. So let's start with, a very, very basic question about your journey as a director, your entire journey in through your employment career and your transformation as a managing director and a director. So, yes, sir, we would be happy to, listen to your journey overall.
Sure. So, with God's grace, I've been at it for about 30 years now. And my life, professional life, can be very well divided into a two-third, one-third frame. So first 20 years, I was a corporate professional. I had the great fortune to start my career with a company called Wipro. I would say even proudly today that whatever culture, systems, and integrity and ethics, and what I am as a professional human being, a lot of it was shaped by my early years at Wipro. It's a fantastic organization in India in terms of the overall way they conduct business and the culture and ethics which they put first. Post that, I had the opportunity, as you kindly mentioned, of starting Cisco Systems in India and growing it from nothing to almost $1 billion, that's $1,000 million business annual run rate in India. During that, I had an opportunity to go live and serve in Singapore, which gave me an opportunity to see very different countries and cultures as well. A great learning experience. My 3 years in Singapore, I had an opportunity to visit and work with 13 countries. They all look very closely bound on the map. But when you go even a few kilometers from one boundary to the other, the cultures, business cultures, etc., are very different. So I would urge every participant who's on this session today that whenever you get an opportunity to work in different geographies, jurisdictions, just grab it. It will really stand you in good stead. So post my Cisco journey, I went and ran a listed company, as Divya mentioned, and then so on and so forth. So I won't get into my quote-unquote curriculum vitae. But I would say there are two or three things which have driven me throughout my career. And I'll say it with all humility, because we can do many things, and I'm a great believer in God. Unless He is with us, we can't achieve much. I would say there are two, three things which have driven me. One is, whatever I did, even in the corporate organization, it was important for me to create an impact. Whatever role you're performing, whether you are a junior officer or the CEO or MD or a compliance person or an aspiring director or a director, if you look to take your job in a way where you can make a difference and impact and leave it, that function, job, role, that team, that organization, in a better position, from a financial parameter perspective, from a team perspective, from a longevity perspective, I think that's what can always motivate people. So impact has always been a great driver for me, and that's always made me look at different opportunities. And eventually, I've been an entrepreneur the last 10 years. I think the other thing is, which has stood me in good stead and I would like to share with you is, I think one of my good qualities, and I have many, many bad qualities, which we'll not talk online on air today. Impatience is one of them. But I'm a curious person in the sense that I like to learn new things. And in today's age, and with all the things available to us, with information, data so easily available, if each of us don't have curiosity and I would say the aspiration to learn new things, we're doing great injustice to ourselves, the functions or organizations that we serve. And then finally, if you ask me why did I go from 20 years of corporate life to becoming an entrepreneur, you realize that in a corporate life, however high you are, you become the MD, you may become the chairman, finally you're walking in the bounds of that corporate and what it wants to achieve, and which is very fair. It is built for something. Now, if you want the freedom as an individual to try new things, eventually to fail or to succeed, that's up to you. Nothing can give you that freedom and that joy. Obviously, there are lots of downsides to entrepreneurship, which you must be knowing, and as Divya and a lot of other people on the show today. But the freedom which entrepreneurship gives you, and let me tell you, it's not very rosy. There are lots of thorns with it. But at the end of the day, you are responsible for your own success. And whatever idea comes to your mind, as long as you have a team which buys into it, you can motivate them and they march with you, they go shoulder to shoulder with you, you can go on your entrepreneurship journey.
So take the question from the exactly same point, how you differentiate your role as an entrepreneur and your role as a director? So because, you know, when you are in a corporate, in an MD position, you know that you are a managing director. But now when you are an entrepreneur, how you differentiate that? Because I think most of the mid-sized businesses, SMEs and MSMEs have been struggling exactly the same place, that they're not able to differentiate their role. So how, you know, you would like to tell the participants to make that differentiation in the mind, basically?
Very smart, but very tough question. These things which to do with the mind and partitioning the mind are not always difficult to do. Not very easy to do, always difficult to do. But having said that, you know, I've had the opportunity to be an executive director, right from MD to being executive, non-independent to independent, non-executive. Whatever permutation combination you can think of, I've had the opportunity, both for listed private as well as startup company. I would say the fundamental thing which a director has to do vis-a-vis the entrepreneur or the promoter, and sometimes you wear both hats. As an entrepreneur, you're also the board member as an executive director. And then you become, from entrepreneur, as you grow, you become promoter, shareholder, etc. And you wear that director hat. I think the differentiation which you need to make is, as an entrepreneur, as a promoter, the first thing, at least in the initial days, that comes to your mind and which occupies and which should occupy every moment of your living life is your organization and how it will succeed, how it will grow, how it will do well. And by organization doing well, I just don't mean the financial parameters and growth. I mean the people involved, the stakeholders, the vendors, etc., etc. Your set of people that you're dealing with. But then when you start wearing your director hat, there are two, I think, changes you need to move. You need to give more primacy to your various stakeholders vis-a-vis your own organization. So you need to move from you as the shareholder mindset to you as a custodian of the various stakeholders of the organization. Globally, there's a great movement now from shareholder to stakeholder primacy. Yes. And that's more to do with economics and large listed companies. But I would say even as an entrepreneur and MSME person, when you start wearing the director hat, you start realizing, when do you become a director? You become a director when you have a board. When do you have a board? You become a board minute you go from being a proprietorship or a partnership firm to a private company, a public company or a listed company. Now, when you're private, public or listed, there is a letter, which the word which comes behind it, which is limited. And we all know that limited stands for your limited liability. So you as an individual now are by law different from the organization. And your liability is separate from that of the organization. But per contra, I would say the other side of the coin of liability is your responsibility. So as you go from becoming a partnership or a proprietorship to a private, to a public, to a listed, and that's when you need boards, you start having less liability as an individual, but you have more responsibility to a larger set of stakeholders. So I think that's a great mindset change, which is not very easy to make, easy to say on a call on a Friday evening, but one has to keep at it, Divya.
Absolutely. So taking this ahead, what are your learnings as an entrepreneur? You know, if you can, because we have, a lot of people who have not been into a private limited kind of a structure, but they aspire to, because government has been giving a lot of incentives and you know there are n number of things or n number of benefits going corporate. So what are your learnings as an entrepreneur, or some hard way, you know, you might have learned something and you would like to share so that people, you always tell me one thing that they don't reinvent the wheel. So, you know, you can help the entrepreneurs with your learnings so that they don't end up in those challenges. So a small quick.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
So first thing I would say, instead of learning, I would start with unlearning. If you've been a corporate person, or say if you've been a professional like a chartered accountant or a CS like you were, and many people on this show would be today, you need to unlearn a lot of what you had in your past life. When you're in that kind of an environment as a CA, CS, professional, or in a corporate, remember there are structures and support systems which have been created to help you. When you become an entrepreneur, you may not have that deva. So you have to unlearn your way of working from your past life. Unlearn, and then learn. The next thing, which is very hard to do as an entrepreneur, and the sooner you get over it as a mental hurdle, is to deal with uncertainties. Ever since I've been an entrepreneur last 10 years, I've interacted with, if not thousands, at least hundreds of entrepreneurs. And I would say at least 80 to 90% of them at some stage in their life would dread the last week of the month. Because in your entrepreneurship journey, when that last week of the month comes, you know you have to start paying your bills, your employee salaries. And as an entrepreneur, when you go through that in your initial phases, that's very scary. You have to go through that. You have to deal with the uncertainty. But all the 80% people I've spoken to and have gone through that have come through it successfully. So you have to have the conviction. But I would say one hard lesson is, if you want to be an entrepreneur, be comfortable with uncertainty. If you are a person who can't handle uncertainty, stay away from entrepreneurship. And then I would say a little contrarian thing. A lot of people say that as an entrepreneur, you should be extremely passionate. You should become your company. You should be so involved in your company that the persona become the same. I completely agree with being passionate, driven, focused. No entrepreneur worth his salt is an entrepreneur if he's not eating, sleeping, showering, cooking, and not thinking of his company. You have to do that. But I would say you have to reach a point where mentally you also differentiate yourself from the company. And that's very important, because as an entrepreneur, I've learned this the hard way. If you don't differentiate yourself from the company, because you're so driven, you're so passionate, you're so committed, you're so involved, but still you have to make that effort to differentiate. Because if you don't differentiate, sometimes your own ego, your own value systems, your own way of thinking, etc., come in the way of taking objective decisions for your company.
I think, very well said, sir. So that's exactly one point, I think, which differentiates struggling entrepreneur to a successful entrepreneur. Because struggling entrepreneurs will always see their organization too much attached to them, whereas successful entrepreneurs will always see themselves detached from their, you know, organizations. Very well taken point. And I'm sure, you know, this is one of my biggest takeaway as a startup entrepreneur. And I'm going to follow that for sure. Because when you said, entrepreneur is eating, sleeping, every time the company is in the mind, and I see it for myself, you know. I just can't think of anything else except mentor my board nowadays. So very well, point taken. And it's going to be one of my biggest takeaways. So next question to you would be, sir, you have worked with MNCs and you have worked with Indian companies as well. And now you have yourself been an Indian, emerging company into the board tech space, as we discussed with Shailesh Bhai today. So you are an emerging company in that space. So what are the basic differences in terms of culture, in terms of thought process you have seen from working in MNCs as a board level and working in the Indian corporates as the board level? So your thought on that, sir?
I think both have their pros and cons. And nowadays, I have seen a little environment in India where people kind of belittle MNCs or global companies. I think we should understand their strengths. If they can go to multiple countries, multiple jurisdictions, multiple markets, multiple cultures, and still succeed, there must be something great about them. We must respect them, right? Yes. The great strengths they have is they have their processes. They also have great advantages, but they have gone through a struggle to reach where they have reached, right? Nothing comes day one, right? So I think the great strengths they have is processes, learnings from global markets. Another great thing they have is access to global talent. They can access globally available best talent. Now in India, that may not always be available to us. And, you know, we may feel patriotic and think that we are the greatest people, but there are people who are out there who have done better stuff, and MNCs have access to that. So if you're an entrepreneur or a board member or a company which is having a competitor, which is a global company or an MNC, always treat them with respect. They have reached their level of success in your market because they have done something right. They have access to global capital, global resources, and more importantly, global talent. And as we say in Hindi, unhone har jagah mein papad vele hue. It's not that you can go into any country and become successful, right? You have to keep reinventing your business model. The way McDonald's has succeeded in India, they had to completely change their menu vis-a-vis what is served in US. You know, if you walk into McDonald's in, if your first entry to McDonald's has been McDonald's India, and then if you go to McDonald's in US, you will not even recognize it. The menus are so different. Similarly with Amazon, you know, the path they have charted here with the seller organization and all of that. So to make it short, they have great strengths. I think where Indian companies score is Indian companies, why are they called Indian? Why do you call them Indian, Divya? Because the original promoter, entrepreneur, major shareholders are Indians. Now that gives them the advantage of knowing the environment, the mahol, the market a lot better. They have only one market, one jurisdiction to focus to. So they can become more nimble, more active. And that's the advantage they have in their own market. So in your own market as an Indian company, you definitely have advantage vis-a-vis a multinational in terms of nimbleness, knowing your market well, etc., etc. But don't ignore their strengths. So I would say both have pros and cons. I wouldn't say one is better than the other. At different points in time, different organizations succeed differently. My only aspiration for Indian companies, and we're starting to see some of it, is I hope more of us go global. Let me take 2 minutes on China. You know, we have a lot of problems, so it's not a very popular country now. Now, for every global platform like Google or Amazon or Facebook, China has their own homegrown great platforms which have 700, 800 million users. So they have Alibaba, they have something from D, which is equivalent to Google, etc. But nobody knows of them. The only product out of China from the digital space which everybody knows about is TikTok. And, you know, we have banned them, they're not good, whatever. But the fact is, the reason TikTok stood out from the other Chinese apps and products is because they chose to go global, compete in those markets, and they succeeded. So I think as an Indian and a patriotic Indian, what I would like to see a lot of our Indian companies, including my little Gaviva and Mentorboy Mode, going global and succeeding with the best.
Wonderful. Absolutely. Absolutely. Sir, now coming to your company, we would like to know, you know, more about Gaviva, what you do. And here, Priya Parab, our you know, digital marketing strategist and advisor to Mentor My Board, would also like to ask you some question on the technology space. So over to you, sir.
Sure. And hi, Priya. Welcome.
Hi. Good evening, sir.
Pleasure so meeting you online.
So happy to be getting a chance to chat with you.
My pleasure. So, yeah, go ahead, Priya.
Yeah. So I would like to take this opportunity to ask who better than you to talk about digitization of boards. So I look at that as what I understand is there are three major aspects. On one aspect, I look at all the humongous amount of data and records, digitization of those, that paperwork, to make board processes more efficient. The second major aspect I look at in terms of digitalization is of the company itself, the corporations itself, like e-banking or e-payments, e-commerce, whatever. So there, I mean, the boards have to have a digital mindset in order to think futuristic, in order to be able to deliver strategies for such kind of growing company. And the third major aspect of digitalization I see is the humongous amount of data analytics that is available for the boards to make strategic decisions. So in all this, do you see that where we are talking of diversity and bringing in women and minorities, there is also need for technologically savvy young blood to come into boards? Or you think, as you said, curiosity and a contextual intelligence and a digital mindset is sufficient for the board of directors to cope with a futuristic digital world in these three major aspects? How do you look at this scenario?
Sure, Pirea, that's a lot of things, but let me try and distill it. Sometimes when you get bombarded with too much, it's better to start with the basic. No, I'm enjoying this. So let's start with the basic. What is the function and purpose of a board? Okay. If you understand that, then we can understand how we can digitize and make them better, and how Mentor My Board can also do a great impactful service. According to me, and I think most people would agree, a board has two kinds of main roles to perform. One is the success, preservation, and further growth of the organization. So its role is towards the organization on whose board it is serving, taking care of their risks, helping with their strategy, helping with their long-term success. So that is a big, big part of the board's role. The other big part of the big board's role, especially when you go public and even with large private, and I would say now even with SME companies and startups, it's the board members, especially the independent board members, and MMB represents quite a few of them, is actually the fiduciary or the trustee of all the external stakeholders of the company. So a board member has this dual, very difficult role where you have to take care of the interests of the company and its success, at the same time ensure that the external stakeholders are well taken care of and managed. Now, if you break that down, the basic objective, there are multiple things which are required, and we'll not get into that. But suffice to say, it becomes very complex. As you rightly mentioned, in today's world, if you don't have contextual data and information on a real-time basis, yeah, you just cannot contribute to success, strategy, any discussion at all, right? So contextual data availability is extremely important. Another thing is speed. You know, if you want to take care of your organization and stakeholders at large, you need to be able to react, process information, use your wisdom and react fast. Now, if you look at contextual data, speed, all of that is best achieved in every other function through digitization and technology. And the boards can also absolutely take care of it. Now, if you come specifically within boards to a very important thing, which is what is the focus of Mentor My Board as well, which is independent directors. And to the question which you asked, this new tribe of directors which will emerge because of legislations which require diversity on the boards. Priya, I don't know if you know, but in jurisdictions like Germany, by December 31st, 2020, every public listed company must have 50% of their board which are ladies.
Oh,
50%. Okay. Now, there are two main things which I will start with independent and then this new set of lady directors and other directors coming. One is the independent director, and I was executive and then became independent. The first thing which struck me was this asymmetry of information. As an independent director, I'm supposed to and I want to contribute as much as the executive director. But on a day-to-day basis, because of the fact that they're running it, they're there, the amount of information they have access to on a real-time basis, the executive director, the independent director will never have, barring what he or she is given a few days before the meeting or in the meeting. Now, if you want to contribute meaningfully, that asymmetry has to be solved. And technologies like what we are doing at Gaviva, etc., are actually trying to solve that problem. That is number one. Number two, if you look at legislation and then also awareness, Now, more and more people want diversity on boards, not just from a gender perspective, but even things like from an ESG perspective. Increasingly, globally, funds, stakeholders are now beginning to measure companies more and more on the environmental, social, and governance impact and performance. Now, your traditional directors who came from a club of people, you know, if you see the top, I would say 500 listed companies in India, with due respect to all of them, there would be one superset which is floating around everywhere. Now, with this new diversity which is coming in, say Priya or a Divya or many other people joining boards, and hundreds of ladies joining the boards in Germany, the day they join a board, vis-a-vis the existing board members, they will be at a disadvantage. Because that board has been functioning for a long time. It has got its collective knowledge, wisdom, information of meeting and working together for a long time. You're suddenly planted there and you're already under a microscope, and I don't like that because of whatever diversity issues, to perform fast, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now, only way a Priya when she joins a board, or a Divya when she joins a board, which there has been an existing clerk, a club of directors, and all the Fräuleins in Germany when they join those boards, is if they have access to real-time contextual information which can be presented in a form which they can process, use, and start contributing. Make sense?
Are you,
the problems which I am saying, right? It is going to become more and more of an open club. I would say that club would go away. And the only way more people will succeed is if we can process and make digital information available. For example, and I have been on many boards, in any board meeting, you'll have a statutory agenda, which normally takes a lot of time. Now, if you have automated all of that, and all those alerts are available to real time on a dashboard as a director, why do you even need to go through that? You just finish that in 5 minutes. Why spend time on that?
Yeah.
Come to the meet, come to the strategy, come to the risk, all of those things, right?
Okay.
And for that, you need contextual data, you need competitor data, you need industry data.
Mm-hmm.
Platforms can provide you that,
yeah.
Right? You may join a board tomorrow where an agenda item comes up, and a lot of the board members will say, oh, we faced this similar problem 5 years back and this is what we did, and it turned out good or bad.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you don't have access to that.
Mm-hmm.
But there is no reason why you should not have it.
Mm-hmm.
Those data in terms of minutes are available. If we can digitize them, use AI, ML, mm-hmm. the same level of intelligence can be made available to the Priyas, the Divyas, Jangus, all of the people on this show today who will join the boards.
Mm-hmm.
So, I hope I've answered your question in a brief way.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's a huge topic in itself.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yes.
Go ahead, Divya.
So, sir, if we speak about your experience as a director, so what you think, you know, are the basic skills a director should have? I know you have spoken a bit about it already, keep learning and all those things, but still, you know, a basic quality of a director which distinguishes him from others, or to succeed,
sure.
What are the basic, you know, the skill set which a director must possess?
I will answer that because I have it packed, and the reason I have it packed is I share one secret with you. I'm a very forgetful person, and to get over that, I create tricks or acronyms to help me remember things.
Mm-hmm.
So to answer your question, to be a successful director, which is D for director, you first need A, B, and C.
Okay.
Okay, that's how I remind myself. So what are the ABC you need to have, or you need to continuously improve so that you become a good D for director? ABC and then D.
Oh, that's okay. Amazing.
Okay, so let me share my version of ABC. Okay, let's start with A. First and foremost, I think you need ability, aptitude, and attitude.
Okay.
I have seen a lot of people who have been successful CEOs, or a great head of HR somewhere, or a great marketing person, who feel that now they're ready to go and serve boards.
Hmm.
I feel that may not be enough. While you're a domain expert and you can contribute your domain at the board, you need overall ability, attitude, and aptitude to now work successfully. So you have to completely keep adding to the ability and talent that you continuously have. For example, I would tell you, I have seen on two boards which I was, where they got extremely successful CEOs as independent directors. One of the gentlemen didn't succeed, and the other, fortunately, was a lady. For all of you on this show today, she did succeed. It was not a gender issue of succeeding, not succeeding. But I figured in hindsight that that CEO who didn't succeed at the board was because he couldn't change his attitude. What do I mean? As a CEO, by virtue of the position and the strength of that seat, he was used to getting information, data, and his way in an organization. When you are on that board, you don't have the power of that CEO anymore, but still you have to make the same impact. You have to change your mindset. You have to work with a team. You have to work with a set of promoters. You have to respect the fact that he has done hard work and succeeded, and you suddenly can't start shooting him to shreds. You have to respect the different people in the departments over there. I think that gentleman couldn't make that attitude change. So that A of ability, adding to what you already have and not thinking that just because I'm a domain expert here, I can make a good director. And then finally, aptitude is very important. Then I'll come to the B. I think finally joining any board is about joining a business organization. So it's very important that you continuously upgrade your business skills, your business knowledge, your business acumen, right? Whatever your domain specialization, if you don't delve more and more into business, how it works, etc., it's not going to help you. In fact, I would say, things like the IICA proficiency test, etc., are good steps, but it can be misleading because someone may pass that and he or she may think that, oh, now I can be a great director. But what about your business skills? I would urge each and every person on this show that if you don't already have that, please go and get, and there are many courses available, basic business finance skills. Because finally, when you enter that boardroom, a lot of discussions are going to happen about numbers. And if you cannot relate to that, question that, be part of that, it's not going to help you. Again, I will tell you from my past experience, I knew of a board member who came in as an HR specialist. He was a brilliant HR guy. He had dealt with unions. He had dealt with white collar workers. He had global exposure. And that's why he was brought on the board of that company, because everybody felt that an HR, that company needed an HR touch. But I would see that guy, he was a gentleman, out of a 3-hour board meeting, about 2 hours, he would be clueless, not in touch at all. Because 2 hours, there would be business and financial discussions. And he had not made the effort to get those basics right. He would understand the P&L because everybody gets it intuitively, right? Your earnings minus your expenses. But balance sheet, you would struggle a bit. Now, I'm not saying as an aspiring director, you need to be an accountant or a chartered accountant and all of that. But certain amount of business finance knowledge, business acumen, business judgment, the B is very important. And finally, I'll come to the C. If you want to be a successful C contributor, C for contribution at the board, you must have courage and confidence. I think a board member has to make an impact. There should be courage. It should not be false courage or false bravado. It should be courage and confidence based out of knowledge, hard work, putting in the hours, doing your research, reading everything, knowing everything about the business, the financials, etc. So then when you're in the board and you are discussing things, you have the courage and confidence to question, to suggest, and then also sometimes stop people from doing things. So this is my own ABC mantra of ability, attitude, aptitude, business knowledge, business acumen, business judgment, and courage and confidence based out of knowledge and hard work, which may make you a successful D4 director.
Wonderful. Absolutely. Aptly said, sir. Priya, over to you for the next question. You are on mute, Priya. Priya, you are on mute.
You are muted.
Yes, Priya.
In the course of the discussion, sir has answered all my questions that I had in mind. So,
Wonderful. So now, kind of a quick rapid fire question. Before that, I have one question about the price sensitive information for the listed entities, you know, especially. So, sir, what because now, price sensitive information and very, very strong and, rules and imminent and hidden dangers of unknown into the insider trading space, So what's in your mind, should be the basic of cybersecurity aspects to be remembered while conducting the board meetings and, where such information is discussed in electronic modes, including sharing of agenda on these platforms. So should directors be aware of and, what precautions they can take? So your say on that, sir.
No, so there are two questions in this. One is the digital and technology cybersecurity, and one is this insider information, etc. I think that comes in the larger context of related party transactions and privileged information. As late as yesterday, we read about the unfortunate things which are happening to the Kochar family because it was a related party transaction. Right now, to my mind, we live in a connected world. There can never be a scenario where there will be zero related party transaction which any organization has. And the law and everybody recognizes that. We live in a connected world. Oh, hone wala hai. But the important things, and this is where the role of the board comes in. You should have proper processes, systems and disclosures. So the flip side of RPT, related party transaction, is disclosure. You should have proper processes, systems, etc., that recognizing, yes, related party transactions will happen, but they should be disclosed. They should be treated at arm's length, and the relevant systems, processes, and people should be involved in that. And I think using digital platforms, and I don't want to talk about my own platform, but things like Gaviba really, really help you in that direction. So one is this whole RPT, price sensitive information, which insiders may have. Other is the whole thing about cybersecurity. People may now get access to information without being insiders through a security breach, a cyber breach, or data can be hacked when it's on its way. For example, if you're uploading from your server on the quarterly information to the Bombay Stock Exchange, it may get hacked, right? And before it goes there, someone hacks it, and the famous NSE case on the servers, it was about milli and microseconds. So I would say it's extremely important that boards and everybody plays a lot of information to cybersecurity and things like that. But in every aspect of life now today, digital technology is inevitable. And just like when you're driving, you have to follow certain safety precautions, like having an airbag and watching the red signals. You just don't stop driving because, it's unsafe. You take precautions. Similarly, you adopt technology, go digital, and increasingly tighten your policies. And one of the big roles which a board should play is on the cybersecurity risk management. So I hope I have answered both your questions. But I would say you have brought out a very, very important point. The world is going digital. This whole discussion we're having today evening, 8 months back, to put it together physically would have taken you 8 weeks, isn't it? Now, digital technology helps you do it so fast, but it has its own cons, which we should be aware of and take care of it. I think now you are on mute.
Yeah. So now we come to a rapid fire round for you, sir.
Okay.
So 3 tips to the fellow compliance tech companies. There are a lot of startups in this space, the legal tech companies, the compliance tech companies, the fintech companies. So 3 quick, tips if you can think of.
I think the simple thing is, it's already a complex, very scary area. And it sounds very basic, but the more you understand your end user, his fears, his anxieties, and what are the problems that you're trying to solve, please understand their problem and solve it. Just because you have a great idea doesn't mean it's solving their problem. So understand your user and, more importantly, their problem. And second is, understand that when you're trying to make someone go from a manual to a digital world, he or she is used to that process for many years or decades sometimes. So make your platform extremely complex, free, extremely user-friendly. Remove all complexity. Don't try to dazzle people with lots of features and things. Make it as easy to use as possible. That is very, very important. It's very difficult to do. If you look at its Zoom screen in front of us today, there are so many buttons and features, but we are not going to use even 10%.
Correct.
Right? Similarly, if you're creating platforms and you expect people to migrate, keep complexity away, understand your users, understand their problems and solve them. Very simple, but I think many people fail in that.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, three life lessons you would like to, you know, tell all of us. Because work-life balance, whether it's men, women, I know everyone struggles. So three life lessons, if you, you know, can share, which directors can, you know, imbibe in.
I would say what has worked for me, I can share. Everybody has their own mantra of success, and next Friday someone else will talk of his or her perspective, which may be equally good or better. As I said, I have these small tricks. So I use the three H's. And for me, what has worked is hard work, humility, and hunger for knowledge. I think in whichever field you are, whether you are an entrepreneur, whether you are an independent director, whatever you are, there is no easy shortcut. You have to work hard. And then as you attain more and more success, if you lose your humility, humility is like integrity. You know, you may appear honest to the world, but most important and most difficult integrity is personal integrity. You can't lie to yourself. Similarly, you know, you may appear modest, but if you're not humble in your thought that I can learn from anybody, I should interact with anybody, I should cooperate with anybody, I think it's not going to work. And finally, is that hunger, you know, keep that curiosity, keep that hunger for new things, new knowledge, new ways of doing things. I think you will succeed.
Wonderful. And finally, three things you think MentorMy Board should focus on.
I think you're already doing all the right things. But I would say what you could probably accelerate and do more of is I think a lot of... So there are two sections of MentorMy Board in terms of the community you serve. One is existing directors. So how can you make them more effective? What tools you can give them? Digital? What knowledge sharing platforms? I think platforms like this where they can interact, get some little wisdom here on there helps a lot. You know, however high you rise in life, there's always this 1 hour session where you get 1 minute of a light up and it helps you. So that's for existing directors. For aspiring directors, I think I met a lot of people who justifiably aspire to be directors, and certain people who are maybe aspiring a little prematurely. And if you can help them assess where they are, where are their gaps, and how you then help them to address those gaps through digital platforms, training, sessions like these. And it's a self-discovery thing. So I would say if you can help people become more self-aware of where they are in their journey for aspiring as well as existing directors in terms of assessments, and then finding the gaps and then helping them address those probably digitally, I think you can add one more feather to your cap.
I think bang on, you know, we have already been talking mutually on that, creating a self-assessment tool for directors, you know, and especially aspiring directors to know on the ladder of directorship, where do they stand? So absolutely we are, you know, we both are working on it, you know, very, very aggressively, and very soon we are going to go live on that.
Super. So,
Bharti wants to ask a question. Go ahead, Bharti. You are there with us throughout this entire session. So please go ahead and you know, ask your question. So I'm done for my questions. And thank you, Jangu sir, for all your absolutely bang on replies.
Thank you very much. Yeah. My pleasure. Bharti.
Hi, Jangu.
Hi, good evening.
Welcome. Good evening. Yeah. So basically, I was like I told you a little while before, I was really intrigued by your profile. So two things which intrigued me was that you're into sailing. So, you know, and very aptly, Divya asked, like, how are your life lessons here? Let me ask you, how do you feel that, you know, sailing has helped in your journey in a directorship?
Say again, Divya. Sorry, Bharti, the last part.
Your skills as a sailor.
So, first thing you learn, Bharti.
How did it help you in your journey as a director? How have you managed to...
Okay. Wonderful question. Sailing is a wonderful hobby, and Mumbai has lots of downsides, but one upside it has, it's got a harbour. So, anybody can drive down and pick up sailing and enjoy it.
Yeah.
The first thing you learn in sailing is you can never sail against the wind. Okay, you can sail with it, perpendicular to it, or you have to harness it in some form or the other. But if you go against the wind, no ship in the world throughout the history of maritime has ever sailed against the wind. That is number one you learn. And number two, you learn that you have to harness the wind. The wind has to become your friend. I think if you take that into our business, professional life, in every life, that don't try to, however strongly you feel about something, beyond a point, don't bang your head against something indefinitely. Go with the flow, but you may not go exactly with the flow. In sailing also, you can go almost 170 degrees, 60 degrees, but you cannot go 90 degrees, right? Go with the flow, go tangentially, but don't go against, and harness the flow. Harness the flow of what's happening. So if the world, for example, is going digital, and if you're going to keep resisting that mentally, although outside you may show that you're doing it, you're going to do yourself a great disservice. That's what I mean by going with the flow and harnessing the flow.
Very good strategies for a director. So thank you. That was wonderful. The other thing is ESG is also a passion of mine. It's far beyond CSR, which I understand is a passion of yours. It's far, far beyond, much more broader in scope as well as in depth. So I wanted to ask you, like, how do you feel that, you know, after the post-COVID era or during the post-COVID era, how would the directors like to make a commercial aspect of ESG mutual funds, ESG funds, you know, and rather than looking only into the CSR aspect of, you know, doing business, while doing business?
No, Bharti, wonderful question. I think... you know, ESG, I'm equally passionate and I share your passion over there. ESG is a need of the hour. We as a generation, as society, as corporate people, as whatever, owe it to give it back to nature, to society at large, whatever we earn. Let's face it, you know, any organization can never say it has succeeded without using external resources which belong to environment and society. You are using something or the other, and it's incumbent on you to respect that and return that. So one is the whole good part of it, the moral part of it. But now if you see over the last 1 year, ESG has also become financially very rewarding. So if you look at the period from, say, February of 2020 to August end of 2020, and there are lots of studies and I can share that with you, funds which were more ESG focused, ESG oriented, have outperformed vanilla normal investors. So funds which are ESG focused, what do? When they select a company, they don't only select it on its financial, business parameters, management team, cash flow, falana, dinkana, but they also look at their ESG performance, commitments, priorities. And those companies and those funds which have invested in them have outperformed the rest of the market by a factor of 15 to 20 percentage points. That's huge. That's number one. Number two, if you look at some of the largest investors in the world, like Blackstone, the amount of money Blackstone has to invest, which is it has invested and it is going to keep investing, is almost equivalent to India's GDP for a year. That's the kind of money they command and that's the kind of power they have. Now, Blackstone has made a public statement that they will not look at companies going forward who are not conscious and contributory towards the ESG imperatives. They've also gone, as and as a lot of people know, funds have this proxy voting practices. So Blackstone has a proxy voting guidelines which they give all their investment managers and all the people that they deal with and the investee companies. They have gone now and articulated that as proxy voters, and they have solid power at the boards, they are going to actually outvote board members. They are going to vote against board members who don't keep ESG fair and square in their sights in the boards which they serve. So, Bharti, you are bang on. This is a great requirement, and it's not just good, it's financially rewarding.
Wonderful. Totally thrilled about it because this is one of my favorite subjects. Thanks, Divya, for giving me this opportunity. And thanks, Jambu, so much. Wonderful insights. So, you know, both the questions you answered in a similar fashion, aligning and harnessing. Economy and ecology go together hand in hand.
Superb, Bharti. You have put it so well.
Wonderful, wonderful.
So, yes, Divya.
Wonderful. So here we come to an end for this today's talk. And there are so many questions coming to my mind, but I know we have, you know, almost been an hour together on this platform. And we had such a wonderful interaction. Thank you, Mr. Jambu, Mr. Dalal. And it was really a wonderful interaction, a fruitful interaction. And I'm sure lots and lots of Indian companies, SMEs, MSMEs really need to move to digital transformation. And as we all know, everything starts from the top. So everything starts from the top. That means the boards have to first go digital. And that's where you have been doing a wonderful job to bring the Indian corporates directors on the digital platform. So hats off to you and thank you for your valuable time and inputs. I, on behalf of Priya, Bharti, and my entire team who's watching us live, and also the audience who have been, you know, every Friday we have been getting such a wonderful response from people. So thank you, everyone. And especially thank you to you once again on behalf of the entire team. So here I would like to tell my audience, keep watching, keep listening, keep sharing these wonderful boardroom talk series. And also do write into the comment if you would like someone, eminent personality to be here with us in this talk series. And we will make sure that we bring them in the coming weeks. So stay tuned, keep watching, keep sharing, and keep motivating us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Divya. Thank you for having me. And thanks to all the participants to take this hour of your Friday evening. One last thought, if any of you would like to connect and get some more thoughts, please come through the MMB platform and I'll be more than happy to have a dialogue with you. Thanks once again and have a good weekend.
Thank you very much, sir.
Bye-bye. Pleasure.
Bye. Thanks a lot. So.